أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا ما لكم إذا قيل لكم انفروا في سبيل الله اثاقلتم إلى الأرض أرضيتم بالحياة الدنيا من الآخرة فما متاع الحياة الدنيا في الآخرة إلا قليل. إلا تنفروا يعذبكم عذابا أليما ويستبدل قوما غيركم ولا تضروه شيئا والله على كل شيء قدير. إلا تنصروه فقد نصره الله إذ أخرجه الذين كفروا ثاني اثنين إذ هما في الغار إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن إن الله معنا فأنزل الله سكينته عليه وأيده بجنود لم تروها وجعل كلمة الذين كفروا السفلى وكلمة الله هي العليا والله عزيز حكيم. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Now from this ayah number 38 till the end of this surah, it's a long discourse which revolves around the Ghazwatul Tabuk. Because actual fighting didn't take place, so we can't call it Ghazwa also, but it can be called expedition, the journey of Tabuk. And these are 11 sections of this surah. Some of these ayat were revealed before the commencement of the journey. Some, as I told you before, during the journey, going towards Tabuk, coming back from Tabuk. And because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Muslim, stayed there at Tabuk for about 2 or 3 weeks, I'm not sure at this time. So some of the ayat were revealed there. And then, you know, some of the ayat were revealed after his coming back and reaching Medina. Now, what is most important about this ghazwa or the journey or the expedition is, as I told you, regarding the philosophy of the deen, this represents the initiation of the process of the Baisatul Ammah, or you may call it the exportation of the Muhammadan revolution, alayhi salatu wassalam. It began, as I told you, in the year 7 of Hijrah, when the Prophet ﷺ wrote letters to Heraclius, to the Emperor of Iran, to Macaucus of Egypt, to Nagus of Abyssinia, and to chiefs of Bahrain and so on and so forth. Now one incident occurred, that is, a letter was sent to Shu'abil bin Amr. He was the king of Ghassan under the Roman Empire, a tributary to the Roman Empire, but so to say, a king in himself, the chief of that area of tribe. The Prophet ﷺ sent him a letter also, and Hazrat Haris ibn Umair Azdi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was the emissary. He took the letter. This fellow, Shu'abil bin Amr, he killed the emissary, the messenger of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, this was an offensive act. It was a challenge to the state of Medina, you may call it. Now it was not of Medina only, it was the whole of Arabia now, nearly. So the Prophet sent, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an army of 3,000 of companions to take the revenge. Now when this army was sent, Heraclius himself, the Roman emperor, was present in Syria. He sent an army of 100,000 people to confront this army of 3,000 only. Another 100,000 were present as a support. So when these people reached, and it was under the command of Hazrat Zayd ibn Harisa رضي الله تعالى عنه, when they came to know that we have to confront 100,000 people, the ratio of 1 to 33 already, and if you know another 100,000 can be added, it becomes 1 to 66. So should we have a confrontation or we should retreat? So most of the people said, no, we need shahada fi sabilillah, victory or no victory, we must go and confront them. So this was the battle of Muta, which was fought in the month of Jamad al-Ula, in the 8th year of Hijri. Now, when the battle started, there was no, comparison. Hazrat Zayd ibn Harisa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was martyred. Then the command, the Prophet had already said, if Zayd ibn Harisa, he falls, then Hazrat Ja'far ibn Abi Talib, a cousin, the elder brother of Hazrat Ali رضي الله تعالى عنه. Then he had to take the command, he took the command, he also fought and he also was martyred. Then according to the instruction of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Abdullah ibn Rawaha, an Ansari from Medina رضي الله عنه, he took the command, he was also martyred. Then the Muslims themselves, now all the three whom the Prophet had nominated, they had been martyrs. So now the Muslims decided themselves over there to make Khalid ibn Walid their chief. And he then somehow, by some maneuvers, he could take them back, and they reached Medina. So this was, in a way, it was a very big success also, to have come back safe out, after confronting 100,000 people. But in a way, it was a defeat also. Now, because Heraclius now became, conscious of the threat to his empire from the south, so he began amassing more army and preparing, because, this could be the soft underbelly, as you call it, of the Roman Empire. If there was a thrust from the south, the whole empire, that could be affected. These news were reaching the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam also. So he now prepared an expedition, decided to go himself, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And this is now called the expedition or the Ghazwa of Tabuk. Two things are very peculiar. And they were, for the first time, these steps were taken. Number one, the target was absolutely declared clear. We are going to confront Rome, so that it should be clear to all people where they are going. They should know it beforehand. Number two, that every mu'min has to go. This is the first and the last occasion during the whole lifetime of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that it was made obligatory for every Muslim, compulsory. You may call it general mobilization in the modern terminology, but every Muslim had to go. So actually, this expedition of Tabuk, the Prophet went there with 30,000 of companions, and he stayed there. Heraclius knew that this army has come, but because he had already recognized that Muhammad is the Prophet of Allah, and he knew it, I can't confront him. So he held back, he didn't come forward. And the Prophet ﷺ stayed there for about 2 or 3 weeks, about 20 days as far as I can recollect. And during this period, he accomplished something which I will give you later on. And then he returned. But what were the accomplishments of this journey? Number one, the Prophet ﷺ showed to the Roman Empire that Islam stands undaunted, not to be cowed down, ready to have a confrontation with the Roman Empire. It was the Roman Empire which, receded back. They didn't come just like Muta. Because in Muta, the Prophet himself was not present. But it was Tabuk now. The Prophet was himself present. And he knew, Heraclius, that if I confront him, I'll be defeated. So So, number one, you know, this morale of the Muslims and this new state, Islamic state in the Arabian Peninsula, the morale of its citizens and all the mu'mineen, you know, it rose high. Number two, when this Prophet stayed there for about 2 weeks or 3 weeks, he made treaties with all the tribes of that area, so that the borders of that Islamic state were become secure. So that was the second accomplishment that he got, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The third was that through this expedition of Tubuk, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the munafiqeen absolutely exposed. And he took a stern action against munafiqeen after coming back. Liquidation of munafiqeen, that was the third accomplishment of this. Because when it was made clear that every mu'min has to go, whosoever didn't go, he became apparent. Although there is something which we shall read inshallah, that they came and they got the leave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam due to some lame excuses. But you know, but it became apparent, who are they? And then you know, their conspiracy that they had built a mosque as a center for their conspiracies. The Prophet, when he came back, the Prophet, he was commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to burn it down and to put it down. So that was a very big blow. And according to some traditions, the Prophet also identified about 30 of them. And you know, he called by names, such and such, son of such and such, should stop, should stand up and leave our place. So this is the only incident in the whole life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he did identify certain munafiqeen, made them apparent and known to the public, to the Muslims, to the mu'mins, that such and such people are munafiqeen. Not all of them, but some of them. But you know, this season in which this expedition was being undertaken was very unfavorable. Hottest days of the Arabian Peninsula. Then you know, there was dearth of, you know, food. And now the harvest of the date that was ready. And there was danger if it is not harvested at proper time, it will also decay. Because you know, harvesting the dates is not an easy job. Women cannot do it. Going up, you know, the high stem of the date palm and then taking the dates from there. So if no men were to remain behind to harvest this crop, it would also go to waste. So all types of, you know, hard trials and tribulations and tests, they were gathered together for the second time during this Madani period. The first time is Ghazwatul Ahzab, hardest test. The Mu'mins, this Hizbullah was put to the hardest test during that also, and rather more hard now, because now people know we are confronting the Roman Empire. Up till now, there was, you know, infighting between the tribes, between the people of Arabia only. But now an established superpower of the time, because at that time also, incidentally, there were two superpowers. The empire of Iran and the empire of Rome. And you know, sometimes the Romans advanced and they captured some area from the Iranians. And on another occasion, the Iranians advanced and captured some area, the Syria and some part of Turkey from Romans. This was happening for the last 600 years or so. The history was, you know, hanging, a seesaw, you know, play was going on between these two empires, the Roman empires on the one hand and the Iranian empire on the other hand. That is why we find, you know, in Surah Ar-Rum in Quran, Alif Lam Mim, Ghulibat Ar-Rum fi Adna Al-Ard, wa hum min ba'di ghalabihim sayaghlibun. So that is an incident which has been referred to in Quran also. So actually, these were the conditions in which Nifaq came out. It became apparent. Munafiqeen could be identified plainly. So this was the third accomplishment of this expedition of Tabuk. Now let us start. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu ma lakum idha qila lakum infiru fi sabilillahi saqaltum ila al-ard. Oh, you who believe. Now note here. Who are being addressed really are not the true mu'mins. These are the munafiqs. But as I told you, nowhere in Quran they have been addressed as Ya ayyuhal ladheena nafaqu or Ya ayyuhal munafiqun. Because legally they were also Muslims. O you who profess to believe, let us translate it that way. Ma lakum, what has happened to you? Iza qila lakum firu fi sabilillah? When it is said to you, go out in the way of Allah. Saqaltum ilal ard. You cling heavily to the earth. Arazitum bil hayati dunya min al akhirah. Have you now preferred life of this world? You are pleased with this life of this world over the akhirah? You are bartering akhirah off in exchange for this worldly life? Fama mataul hayati dunya fil akhirati illa qalil. So all these, the comforts and the material of this worldly life as compared to akhirah, is equal to zero. Qaleel means the little. A little. As if it's nothing. As I told you, the finite compared to infinite comes to zero. What is it? Nothing. Illa tanfiru yu'azzibkum azaban aleema. If you don't go out to fight for the cause of Allah, this is the critical time for this newly born Islamic state. This system of Khilafah is threatened from the north. And now everyone has to come forward to defend it. In la tanfiru yu'azzibkum azaban aleema. Allah will give you a very painful torment and punishment. وَيَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ. And he will remove you and bring another nation in your place. وَلَا تَذُرُوهُ شَيْعًا. You will not be able to do any harm to him. وَاللَّهُ وَلَا كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. And Allah has power of on everything. إِلَّا تَنْصُرُوهُ. If you don't help him, whom? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know the mission was assigned to Muhammad. هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالْدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. It was his duty basically as the messenger of Allah to make the deen of Allah supreme. So whoever was helping him actually, whoever was participating in this jihad, he was helping him. The mission was his. إِلَّا تَنْصُرُوهُ. If you don't help him, فَقَدْ نَصَرَهُ اللَّهُ. Allah has been helping him. He doesn't care about you. إِذْ أَخْرَجَهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. When those who disbelieved, they expelled him from Makkah. ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ إِذْهُمَا فِي الْغَارِ. He was the second of the two, where both of them were in a cave, the cave of Sa'r, where the Prophet ﷺ, after coming out from his home, he stayed for 3 days and three nights. Both of them, Hazrat Abu Bakr and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were, you know, they kept hiding there. Is yaqulu li sahibihi, when he said, he was saying to his companion, that is Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, la tahzan, don't be grieved. Inna Allah ma'ana, verily Allah is with us. You know the details of this incident, every Muslim knows. فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ سَكِينَتَهُ عَلَيْهِ. So Allah sent down His calm and tranquility over him. وَأَيَّدَهُ بِجُنُودٍ لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. And He helped him with the army's hosts, which you could not see, of the angels. وَجَعَلَ كَلِمَةَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا السُّفْلَى. And He made the word of those who disbelieved lowest. وَكَلِمَةُ اللَّهِ الْعُلْيَا. And the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the supreme, is the uppermost. Wallahu azizul hakeem. And Allah is all powerful, all authority, and all wise. Infiru khifafam wa thiqala. You have to go out, whether you are khifaf or you are siqal. Now there are two meanings of these words. Khifaf, having less arms and rations. You don't have sufficient arms and rations. Even then you have to go out. Number two, if the inclination of the heart, inclination is present, then a man feels light. I'm going lightly. And siqal, when you are fully loaded with your arms and provisions, or when you have to go, you know, heavy-hearted. You don't want to do. You want to go. You have to go. That is, you know, the words in the bayah, بايعنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على السمع والطاعة في العسر واليسر والمنشة والمكر. في العسر واليسر whether the conditions are easy, favorable or they are difficult. والمنشة والمكر whether we feel inclined to do it or we have to force ourselves to do it. But we shall obey whatever command comes from you. So now these are the two meanings. You have to go out whether you have more arms and provisions or you have less arms and provisions. In the same way, you have to go out whether you feel inclined or you have to force yourself to do it. انفروا خفافا وثقالا وجاهدوا بأموالكم وأنفسكم في سبيل الله. And make jihad in the way of Allah with your belongings, your riches and your lives. ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. This is better for you if you know, if you have the real knowledge. لَوْ كَانَ عَرَضًا قَرِيبًا وَسَفَرًا قَاصِدًا لَاتَّبَعُوكَ. If the gain was near at hand and the journey was short, they would have followed you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But now because it's a very long journey, going all the way to Syria in such a hot season, hot weather. وَلَكِنْ بَعُدَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الشُّقَّةِ. The distance was too far from them. وَسَيَحْلِفُونَ بِاللَّهِ لَوْ اسْتَطَعْنَا لَأَخْرَجْنَا مَعَكُمْ. And they will swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that had it been possible for us, they would have gone with you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يُهْلِكُونَ أَنفُسَهُمْ. They are destroying their own selves by telling this lie. والله يعلم بأنهم لكاذبون. Allah very well knows that they are telling a lie. They are liars. عفى الله عنك. Now this عفى الله عنك has two meanings. May Allah forgive you, or Allah has forgiven you. These two both universe. رضي الله عنه. Allah has been pleased with them, and may Allah be pleased with him. So actually, these both translations would be correct. Allah has forgiven you, or may Allah forgive you. لِمَا زِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Why did you grant them the leave? When a munafiq came, oh, Ya Rasulullah, it's very difficult for me. These are the conditions. My wife is sick. Nobody is there to look after her. Or my parents, nobody is there to look after them. And this is such and this is that. And the Prophet said, okay, you are granted leave. أَفَلَّهُ. May Allah pardon you, or Allah has pardoned you. لِمَا زِمْتَ لَهُمْ. Why did you grant them leave? حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَتَعْلَمَ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Until it became clear for you, it would have become clear for you, who are the true in their statements and who are only telling a lie. If you didn't grant them the permission, they would not have gone with you. But you know, their nifaq would have come to the surface. That they are disobeying without, you know, the permission, the explicit permission of the Prophet ﷺ. If they hold back, their nifaq will become apparent, would have become apparent. But now when you have given them the leave, the cover remains over their nifaq. لَا يَسْتَعْذِنُكَ الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Those who really believe in Allah and the last day, they never ask for any leave. أَيُّ جَاهِدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ. Leave from this, that they should make jihad for the cause of Allah. Who mu'min will turn his face away from it? No truly believing mu'min can ask for permission of leave. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِالْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah very well knows the people who are really God-fearing, who are really conscious of Allah. إِنَّمَا يَسْتَعْدُنُكَ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Actually, only those people come to take, to beg for leave, you know, and permission not to go with you, who don't believe really in Allah and the last day. وَرْتَابَتْ قُلُوبَهُمْ. And you know their hearts are in doubts. فَهُمْ فِي رَيْبِهِمْ يَتَرَدَّدُونَ. And they are wavering in their doubts. The same word, you know, which we read in Surah An-Nisa, مُزَبْزَبِينَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ. The same is يَتَرَدَّدُونَ, مُتَرَدِّد. Whether I should go, I should not go. Well, if I don't go, my nifaq will become apparent. People will know it. They know it. My neighbors know that all these lame excuses that I presented, they are false. But I should go. But again, the fear of death. and all the hardships that were to be borne that kept him back. So this is taraddud. Muzabzabina baina zalik, mutaraddadina baina zalik. فَهُمْ فِي رَيْبِهِمْ يَتَرَدَّدُونَ وَلَوْ أَرَادُوا الْخُرُوجَ لَعَدُّوا لَهُ عُدَّةً. Had they really intended to go out for war and fighting, they would have made the preparations. وَلَكِنْ كَرِهَ اللَّهُ إِنْبِعَاثَهُمْ. Now this is very important. Allah himself didn't like that they should go out. And the reason would come later on. فَصَبَّتَهُمْ. So Allah made them make a pause. The Allah made them lagging behind. سَبَّتَهُمْ وَقِيلَ قُعُدُوا مَعَ الْقَاعِدِينَ. And it was said to them that, okay, you sit back with those who are sitting back, who are not going out. Now comes the wisdom of this decision of Allah. لَوْ خَرَجُوا فِيكُمْ مَا زَادُوكُمْ إِلَّا خَبَالًا. Had they come out with you and accompanied you, they would not have increased anything for you but trouble, making conspiracies, saying something here, whispering here, against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, going there, saying something else over there. مَا زَادُوكُمْ إِلَّا خَبَالًا وَلَأَوْضَعُوا خِلَالَكُمْ يَبْغُونَكُمُ الْفِتْنَةِ. And they would have gone hurried to and fro to bring some sedition or prone to be incited. يَبْغُونَكُمُ الْفِتْنَةِ وَفِيكُمْ سَمَّعُونَ لَهُمْ. And there are people, you know, who listened to them among you, because these munafis, you know, they were rich people, influential people. So now though some of the people from Aus and Khadraj, they used to listen to them. They are our chieftains. For example, Abdullah ibn Ubay was the chief, and you know it had been decided that he will be declared the king of Yasrib. But when the Prophet came, all his dreams, you know, they were shattered. So actually these were, you know, people who had resources. So there were people who would have listened to them if they were with you in this journey, they would have created trouble. وَفِيكُمْ سَمَّعُونَ لَهُمْ. لَهُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِالظَّالِمِينَ. Allah very well knows this zalimeen. Now this is very important. They didn't go. Allah also said don't go. So Allah is attributing it to himself. We made them sit back. And those who decided to go, Allah made it easy for them to go. So if they will say, Allah made the conditions favorable for us that we could come out. So attributing to Allah and attributing to yourself, both things are absolutely correct. I want to lift this. I cannot lift it without the permission of Allah. So I can say, I have lifted it. I can say, Allah has make me lift it. Both things are absolutely correct. Every action, every movement necessarily has two elements. An intention from a person and the permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can attribute it to the person or to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَكِنْ كَرِهَ اللَّهُ إِنْبَعَاثَهُمْ فَصَبَّتَهُمْ وَقِيلَ قُعُدُوا مَعَ الْقَاعِدِينَ لَوْ خَرَجُوا فِيكُمْ مَا زَادُوكُمْ إِلَّا خَبَالًا وَلَأَوْضَعُوا خِلَالَكُمْ يَبْغُونَكُمُ الْفِتْنَةَ وَفِيكُمْ سَمَّاعُونَ لَهُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِالظَّالِمِينَ. لَقَدْ ابْتَغَوُا الْفِتْنَةَ مِنْ قَبْلُ. They have been creating dissension and chaos for you. وَقَلَّبُوا لَكَ الْأُمُورَ. And they have been upsetting the matters for you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for all these long years at Medina. What they had been doing. 300 of them came back from Uhud. That was only the third year after the Hijrah. And such a big, you know, incident. Out of an army of 1,300 deserters. And they deserted and they came back when, you know, both the armies were eye to eye with each other. They were within the sight of each of the armies. The morale of the people who remained must also have suffered a shock. We were 1,000. Already we were one third of the enemy. They are 3,000. We were 1,000. Now from 1,300 is gone. What would be the effect? Natural effect. This natural effect definitely was there. So they have been doing it all along. لَقَدْ اِبْتَغَبُوا الْفِتْنَةَ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَقَلَّبُوا لَكَ الْأُمُورَ حَتَّى جَعَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَرَ أَمْرُ اللَّهِ. Until Haqq, the truth, came and the decision and decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appeared. This refers to the victory of Makkah. Because this is the 9th year of Hijrah in which these ayat are being revealed. And a year before, rather more than a year before, the Prophet had the victory of Makkah. So that was the final, you know, symbol of final victory, of triumph, final triumph over the Arabian Peninsula. Hatta jaal haq wa zahar abrullah wa hum karihun. They didn't like it. The hypocrites, they didn't like it. Wa minhum man yaqulu dhalli wa la taftinni. And among them are people who say, oh Prophet, just give me leave. Permit me to hold back and not go. And don't put me to a test. You know, I beg that you don't put me to a test. Ala fil fitnati saqatu. They have fallen in the test. They have already failed in the test. This ayah refers to an incident. There was a munafiq, Jadd ibn Qais. And you know, he was such a, what to say, you know, such a naughty type of man. He came to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, I am a very weak person. And you know, women are my weakness. And these Roman and Syrian women, they are very beautiful. So if I go there, I won't be able to hold myself. So this will be a very big test for me. So it's better, please, you don't put me to that test. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَقُولُوا ذَلِّي وَلَا تَفْتِنِّي. Don't put me to the test. أَلَا فِي الْفِتْنَةِ سَقَطُوا. They have already failed the test. When they said, I don't want to go to fight for the cause of Allah, they have failed the test. وَإِنَّ جَهَنَّمَ لَمُحِيطَةٌ بِالْكَافِرِينَ. And definitely, hell has already encircled all these kuffar. إِن تُصِبْكَ حَسَنَةٌ تَسُوهُمْ. If some good fortune comes to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to the Muslims, تَسُوهُمْ. They feel sorry for it. They are offended. وَإِن تُصِبْكَ مُصِيبَةٌ. And if some calamity befalls, some misfortune, some unpleasant thing comes to you, يَقُولُ قَدْ أَخَذْنَا أَمْرَنَا مِنْ قَبْلُ. They say, oh, we had taken care of our affairs already. We were not fools like them to put ourselves into such dangers and risks and risk our lives and property. So we have taken care of everything. وَيَتَوَلَّوْا وَهُمْ فَرِحُونَ. And then they go back and they rejoice that this calamity has befallen the Muslims and this loss has come to them. They rejoice. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا. Now this ayat is very important. Every one of us should remember this ayah by heart. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا هُوَ مَوْلَانَا. Tell them, nothing can befall us except that which our Lord, our Rabb, مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا. Allah has written for us. He has decreed. He has decided for us. هُوَ مَوْلَانَا. And He is our Lord, He is our protector, He is our friend. Whatever my friend, you know, puts down in my glass, it's all his bounty. He knows better what is good for me. Whether victory is good for me or being killed in the way of Allah is better for me. So we just give ourselves to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is called tafweezul amri ilallah. We give our affairs in the hands of Allah. وَفَوَّضُ أَمْرِ إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بَصِيرٌ بِالْعِبَادِ. He very well knows, he is seeing what are my conditions. Whatever he decides is good for me. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا هُوَ مَوْلَانَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And the believers must put their whole faith and trust in Allah. قُلْ هَلْ تَرَبَّصُونَ بِنَا إِلَّا إِلَى الْحُسْنَيَيْنِ. Another ayah. These two ayahs are very important for every Muslim, especially a person who has this dynamic concept of deen and who has decided to devote his life for this jihad and for this struggle to establish the deen of Allah. Because examinations after examinations, tests and tribulations and trials after trials will be coming. So these two ayat قل لن يصيبنا الا ما كتب الله لنا هو مولانا وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون قل هل تربصون بنا الا احدى الحسنيين سے ڈو یو ویٹ فار اس وٹ کین یو ویٹ فار اس ایکسپٹ ٹو ویری گڈ ریزلٹس احدى الحسنيين حسنا از فیمنن آف احسن فرام اکبر کبرا فرام اعظم عظما احسن حسنا احدى الحسنيين ٹو موسٹ بیوٹیفل یو نو ریزلٹس کین کم ٹو اس ایون اف وی آر ناٹ ٹائرڈ اٹس دا بیسٹ دیٹ وی کین گیٹ ایون اف وی اینڈ اف وی ریٹرن وکٹوریس دین یو ویل آلسو سے دیٹ اٹ از گڈ فار اس سو دیر از نو فیئر آف اینی تھنگ بیڈ فار اس فار اے ریئل مومن نتھنگ بیڈ کین کم ٹو ہم دی ورسٹ از دیٹ ہی لوزز ہز لائف اینڈ ہی تھنکس اٹ از دی بیسٹ As you know, I gave you the couplet. گل حسر مرنے پہ ہو جس کی امید نہ امید اس کی دیکھا چاہیے Who has put all his hopes in dying for the cause of for some cause. Now he will not have to despair at any stage. He is ready to give everything. قُلْ هَلْ تَرَبَّصُونَ بِنَا إِلَّا إِحْدَى الْحُسْنَيَيْنِ Two of the best rewards. وَنَحْنُ نَتَرَبَّصُ بِكُمْ And we are also waiting for you. أَنْ يُصِيبَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابٍ مِّنْ عِنْدِهِ Either Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inflicts you with some torment and chastisement from Him, or بَيْدِينَ or on our hands. Maybe He allows us to punish you. Up till now, we have not been allowed to punish you. We have taken you as Muslims because you are testifying that there is no God except Allah and Muhammad is His messenger. We have accepted you as Muslims. But maybe a time comes when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes this cover off from you and He allows us to punish you. وَنَحْنُ نَتَرَبَّصُ بِكُمْ أَنْ يُصِيبَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابٍ مِّنْ عِنْدِهِ أَوْ بِأَيْدِينَا فَتَرَبَّصُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ مُتَرَبِّصُونَ So now wait, you also and we are also waiting. قُلْ أَنْفِقُوا طَاعًا أَوْ كَرْهًا Tell them, say to them, whether you spend for the cause of Allah willingly or forcibly, forcing yourself, not liking it, لَنْ يُتَقَبَّلَ مِنْكُمْ It will not be accepted from you now. Now this was their, you know, their habit. Whenever, you know, such a time came, now go, انصروا فی سبیل اللہ, go to fight for the cause of Allah. Oh, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, grant me permission not to go, but I am ready to donate this much. So that, you know, this becomes a compensation for not going. And that was only to cover up their cowardice. Now here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared, now their donations will not be accepted. قُلْ أَنْفِقُوا طَاعًا أَوْ كَرْهًا لَنْ يُتَقَبَّلَ مِنْكُمْ إِنَّكُمْ كُنْتُمْ قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ Now you have really transgressed and you have just joined, really and actually joined the transgressors. فَمَا مَنَعُوا أَنْ تُقْبَلَ مِنْهُمْ نَفَقَاتُهُمْ And there is nothing that prevents that their donations may be accepted. إِلَّا أَنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ But the reason is that they have done kufr with Allah. Although they claim to be Muslims, but now their nifaq has reached that level that actually all iman has gone from them. It's only a veneer. You know the termite when it eats the wood, it leaves a veneer intact so that people who own the house, they don't know that the whole wood has been eaten away. They leave that veneer intact. So wise are they. In the same way, this veneer of legal Islam was intact. But from within, the whole of Iman had gone. So really, they were now kafirs. Although legally, they had the cover of Islam. وَمَا مَنَعَهُمْ أَن تُقْبَلَ مِنْهُمْ نَفَقَاتُهُمْ إِلَّا أَنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَبِرَسُولِهِ They have already committed kufr and rejected Allah as well as His Messenger. وَلَا يَعْتُونَ الصَّلَاةَ إِلَّا وَهُمْ كُسَالَى And they don't approach prayer, salah, but only lazily. Because they have to, you know, keep themselves counted as Muslims. وَلَا يُنْفِقُونَ إِلَّا وَهُمْ كَارِهُونَ And they don't spend anything, they don't donate anything, except unwillingly. not from their own hearts, not willingly. فَلَا تُعْجِبْكَ أَمْوَالُهُمْ وَلَا أَوْلَادُهُمْ. So, O Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't be amazed at their riches as well as their children. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ بِهَا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. What Allah intends is to punish them, to chastise them on account of these very two things in this life of this world. Their children will be rebelling against them. They will become a source of chastisement and azab in this world. This maal, this belonging, this property, this riches, always fearing lest it is lost, lest it is gone. So actually, they are being punished in this life also. So actually these two things, you know, they would become the basis and vehicle of punishment for them in this worldly life. وَتَزْحَقَ أَنفُسُهُمْ وَهُمْ كَافِرُونَ. And their souls will go out of their bodies in this state of kufr. وَيَعْرِفُونَ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُمْ لَمِنْكُمْ. And they swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they are from amongst you. We are with you. We are also Mu'mins. Just trust us. It was actually, you know, for them, for me, it became impossible. I wanted from the very depths of my heart to go with you. But I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't suspect, don't have any suspicions about my iman. وَيَحْلِفُونَ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّهُمْ لَمِنْكُمْ وَمَا هُمْ مِنْكُمْ. Actually, they are not from amongst you. لَكِنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ يَفْرَقُونَ. They are afraid of you. They can't declare their kufr. They know now Muhammad is the authority in the whole of Arabia. They know. The Muslims, you know, the tables have already been turned after the victory of Makkah. Who can challenge them now? So because they are afraid, they don't say openly that we don't believe in what you believe. And they have to say that we are also Mu'mins. But it's only out of fear. وَلَكِنَّهُمْ قَوْمِ يَفْرَقُونَ. They are afraid of you. لَوْ يَجِدُونَ مَلْجَانْ أَوْ مَغَارَاتٍ أَوْ مُدَّخَلًا لَوَلَّوْا إِلَيْهِ وَهُمْ يَجْمَحُونَ. Had they, could they find any refuge or some caves or some other place to enter there and hide, they would have gone and run towards them. لَوَلَّوْا إِلَيْهِ. They would have gone towards them. وَهُمْ يَجْمَحُونَ. Very rushingly. They don't find any refuge now. Where to go? The whole of Arabian Peninsula is under Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we have no place to run, no place to go. لَوْ يَجِدُونَ مَلْجَانْ أَوْ مَغَارَاتٍ أَوْ مُدَّخَلًا. Had they found any place of refuge or any caves or any other place where they could hide themselves, they would have gone to them pressingly. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَلْمِزُكَ فِي الصَّدَقَاتِ. And there are some who blame you, O Prophet, in the distribution of charity and alms. When you know sadaqat came and zakah came and that was to be distributed among the Muslims, then you know these people said, oh, you are not doing justice. You have given more to this person. You are giving less to me. There was an incident. A munafiq said, Erdil ya Muhammad. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you must do justice. And you know, the Prophet was angered and he said, إِلَّمْ عَدِلْ فَمَنْ يَعْدِلْ. If I don't do justice, who will do justice? So actually, he was so much offended on this comment. إِلَّمْ يَا مُحَمَّدْ. وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَلْمِذُكَ فِي الصَّدَقَاتِ. They blame you. فَإِنْ أُعْتُوا مِنْهَا رَضُوا. If they are given from that, they are pleased. وَإِلَّمْ يُعْطَوْا مِنْهَا إِذَا هُمْ يَسْخَطُونَ. And if they are not given, then they are enraged, they are angry. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَضُوا مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Now this surah, you know, just like Suratul Nisa, this surah is also, many of its, you know, ayat, they are devoted to the discussion of these munafiqeen, and their symptoms and signs, and their diseases, all these things, you know. Suratul Nisa, as we read, and this Suratul Tawbah. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَضُوا مَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. And had they been pleased and contented with what Allah and His Messenger had given them. وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهِ. And if they had said that Allah is sufficient for us, سَيُوتِينَ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. If not this time, inshallah, Allah and His Messenger will give us from their bounty. إِنَّا إِلَى اللَّهِ رَاغِبُونَ. We turn humbly towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had this been their condition, it would have been better for them. So the words لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ, they are not here mentioned, but implied. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ رَضُوا مَا أَتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ سَيُؤْتِينَ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ وَرَسُولُهُ إِنَّا اللَّهِ رَاغِبُونَ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ. Had they said these words, it would have been much better for them. إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ. Now these sadaqat, the obligatory sadaqah. Sadaqat are obligatory, that is zakah. And voluntary, that is sadaqah, in our general terminology. But Quran has used for zakah also this word sadaqah. This is obligatory alms than charity. And this is the ayah which gives, you know, the rules regarding whom this zakat can be given. إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ. The alms, the obligatory alms, zakah, are only for the poor. وَالْمَسَاكِينَ, and the needy. وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا, those employed to administer them. To collect the zakat and to distribute, there may be a department, the salaries of those people will also be, can be given from this same zakah. وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبِهِمْ, and those whose hearts are to be softened. If there are some enemies of Allah, but you think that if you can give something to them, you know, their harm will decrease. So even to non-Muslims, that zakah could be given. But, you know, Hazrat Umar said that now that Islam is now dominating, now this item of giving zakah to such people, to just soften their hearts, it has gone. After Islam has become dominant. وَفِي الرِّقَابِ, and to free the slaves, والغارمين, and to help those who are in debts, وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and in the way of Allah, for jihad, for propagation of the word of Allah, and for the struggle of establishing the deen of Allah, you can spend. Should I stop? What about this light? Okay. إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ, and for the wayfarers, the travelers. فَرِيضَةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ. This is an ordinance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fixed. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمِ, and Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. وَمِنْهُمُ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ النَّبِيِّ, and from among these munafiqeen there are people who hurt the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And for example, one example is وَيَقُولُونَ هُوَ أُذُنٌ, and they say, oh, he is merely ears, nothing else. He listens to everything, believes everything. You know, his upper story is vacant. He doesn't know that I am telling a lie. He doesn't know. He can't discriminate between true and false. He just believes in everybody. He is Uzun. يَقُولُنَ هُوَ أُذُنٌ. قُلْ أُذُنُ خَيْرٍ لَكُمْ. Tell them, these ears are better for you. Had he not believed, taken you to the task, you would have been in trouble. يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَيُؤْمِنُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَيُؤْمِنُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Note this. Iman with ba. It is faith, conviction. Iman with lam. These two propositions are different. When you know that iman in true faith, it is with ba. Preposition is ba. Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi yuminuna bil ghaib. Aminu billahi wa rasulihi. But iman with lam is just to accept what you are saying, not contradicting. So he has full faith, yuminu billahi wa yuminu lil mu'mineen. But he accepts the statements of the Muslims, okay? He doesn't say, you are telling a lie. Only, you know, out of his gentleness of nature. He doesn't like to say You are a liar. قُلْ هُوَ أُذُنُ خَيْرٍ لَكُمْ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَيُؤْمِنُ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا And he is the mercy for the true believers منكم who are the true believers from amongst you. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ And as for those who hurt the messenger of Allah, for them is a painful torment. يَحْلِفُونَ بِاللَّهِ لَكُمْ لَيُرْضُوكُمْ They swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Muslims, to please you somehow. Oh, wallahi, billahi, I swear by Allah. This was the cause, this is the reason. Only to keep you pleased. Wallahu wa rasulahu haqqa yudhu. And actually Allah and His Messenger have more right that they should try to please them, not to Muslims. They should try to please Allah and His Messenger. إِن كَانُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ if they are real mu'mins. أَلَمْ يَعْلَمُوا أَنَّهُ مَنْ يُحَادِدِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَنَّ لَهُ نَارَ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدًا فِيهَا ذَلِكَ الْخِزْيُ الْعَظِيمُ Don't they know that whosoever is hostile towards Allah and His Messenger, for him is the fire of hell, wherein he will abide forever. ذَلِكَ الْخِزْيُ الْعَظِيمُ And this is the worst humiliation. يَحْذَرُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ أَن تُنَزَّلَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُورَةٌ These munafiq, these hypocrites, keep fearing, lest some surah is revealed on them. And I will tell you what this means. تُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ Which will tell them, disclose to them what is in their hearts. It can be interpreted and translated in two ways. They are fearful lest some Surah is revealed to the Muslims, which tells them of whatever is hidden in the hearts of the munafiqeen. This is one way. And you know, they are fearing lest some surah is sent down on the Muslims, which you know tells them what is in their hearts, shows the mirror to them. Whatever is in their hearts becomes apparent before them. قُلْ اسْتَهْزِئُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مُخْرِجُ مَا تَحْذَرُونَ And this, tell to them, say to them, well, you keep on mocking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring out what you are fearing. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ لَيَقُولُنَّ إِنَّا كُنَّا نَخُوضُ وَنَلْعَبُ Many such things reached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He used to call explanation. Did you say these things? Now their plea was, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ And if you ask their explanations, if you ask them, لَيَقُولُنَّ they will surely say, إِنَّا كُنَّا نَخُوزُ Oh, Prophet of Allah, it was just a light talk. It was nothing serious. We were just playing and joking. Look to this person, he has reported it better to you. He's a fool. He's a mischief monger. He has reported it. We were not serious, we were just joking. He's talking, you know. It was just a light gossip, nothing more. قُلْ أَبِاللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ Say, you were mocking at and jokingly mentioning the ayat of Allah. أَبِاللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ Mocking at Allah and His revelations. And mocking at his messenger. كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ They were mocking about them. لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ Now don't present before us lame excuses. You have committed kufr after your iman. You have lost all iman. You have gone back. إِنَّا فُوَنْ تَعِفَةٍ مِّنْكُمْ If we ignore and turn our eyes from some of you, نُعَزِّبْ تَعِفَةً Some of you we shall punish. And as I told you, Some of the people were made absolutely clear and declared that they are munafiqeen and they were cast out from the society of the Muslims. In nafu an ta'ifatin minkum, from some of you, we might turn our eyes away, ignore them, leave them. Nazib ta'ifatin. Now the time has come that to some we shall punish. بِأَنَّهُمْ قَانُوا مُجْرِمِينَ Because they are the guilty people, sinners. الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْضُ the munafiq men and the munafiq women, they are from one another. Which we say in Urdu, ek hi thaili ke chatte batte hain. They are all related to each other. Although they might not be related, might not be having any blood relations. Ba'dhum min ba'd. And what are they doing? Ya'muruna bil munkar. They are enjoining what is wrong, what is unjust, what is a sin. وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمَعْرُوفِ. And forbidding from what is good, what is ma'ruf. The contrary that they should have done if they were true mu'mins. يَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. بَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. But they are the reverse, in the reverse direction. يَعْمُرُونَ بِالْمُنْكَرِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَقْبِضُونَ أَيْدِيَهُمْ. They are withholding their hands, not spending in the way of Allah. نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَنَسِيَهُمْ. They have ignored Allah, they have forgotten Allah, and Allah has also forgotten them. إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Verily, these hypocrites, they are the transgressors. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised these hypocrite men and women, وَالْكُفَّارَ and the unbelievers. Now they will be bracketed in the hereafter. In this world they have been bracketed with the mu'mins, legally Muslims. But in the akhirah, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُنَافِقِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتِ وَالْكُفَّارَ نَارَ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. Fire of hell in which they will remain forever. هِيَ حَسْبُهُمْ. It will suffice them. وَلَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ. Allah will curse them. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ. And for them there will be a lasting punishment. كَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Like those who were before you. كَانُوا أَشَدَّ مِنْكُمْ قُوَّةً. They were much more in power and strength than you. Now this refers to the older people, you know. The people of Nuh and people of Hud and so on. وَأَكْثَرَ أَمْوَالًا وَأَوْلَادًا. They were much more in wealth also and in children also. فَاسْتَمْتَعُوا بِخَلَاقِهِمْ. They had enjoyed their lot. فَاسْتَمْتَعْتُمْ بِخَلَاقِكُمْ. You have also enjoyed your lot in this world. كَمَا اسْتَمْتَعَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ بِخَلَاقِهِمْ. Just as those who were before you, they enjoyed their lot. وَخُسْتُمْ كَالَّذِي خَاذُوا. And you also indulge in meaningless talks just as they indulge. أُولَٰئِكَ حَبِطَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. They are the people whose all good deeds have gone in vain in this world as well as in the hereafter. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. And definitely they are the people who are the losers. أَلَمْ يَأْتِهِمْ نَبَأُ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. This is now the clarification of that point. Who people are mentioned here? Have not the news come to them already? Because, you know, these things have been discussed in the Makki surahs. We have recently read, you know, in Suratul Araf, all these stories. But here in one ayah, all these things are referred. أَلَمْ يَأْتِهِمْ نَبَأُ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ قَوْمُ نُوحٍ وَعَادٍ وَثَمُودَ وَقَوْمِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَأَصْحَابِ مَدْيَنَ وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَاتِ. The people of Nuh and the Aad and the Samud and the people of Ibrahim and Ashab Madian, people who dwelt, you know, there in Madian. Wal Mutafiqat, and people of those two cities who were overturned. Sodom and Gomorrah, to which Hazrat Lut a.s. was sent. Atathum Rusulhum bil Bayyinat. To them came their messengers with clear teachings, clear signs, clear proofs, clear miracles. فَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيَظْلِمَهُمْ وَلَكِنْ كَانُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ. So it was not Allah who wronged to them. Actually, they wronged to their own selves. Now, as a contrast, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. Now, just see to the contrast. الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. The mu'min men and women, they are friends to each other. This word wali was not used for munafiqeen. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُنَافِقِينَ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. Because munafiq is not sincere to anybody. They were not sincere to each other even. Could they be sincere, they would have been sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they could have any sincerity, their sincerity would have been for the messenger of Allah, for the mu'mineen. They were not sincere. Therefore, الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ مِنْ بَعْضٍ. And compared it with وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. They are sincerely with each other. They are friends, they are protectors. And what is their يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. They ordain and enjoy whatever is ma'roof, whatever is good. وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ and they forbid from whatever is wrong and unjust. يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ, they establish the prayer. وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ and they pay the zakah. وَيُطِيعُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ and they keep on obeying Allah and His Messenger. أُولَٰئِكَ سَيَرْحَمُهُمُ اللَّهُ, they are the people whom the mercy of Allah will come. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ, verily Allah is Aziz, all powerful, and He is Hakim, all wise. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ, Allah has promised to these mu'min, men and women, the gardens underneath which rivers will be flowing. وَمَسَاكِنَ طَيِّبَةً and very pleasant dwellings, very good, lovely dwellings, فِي جَنَّاتِ عَدْنٍ, in the garden of Eden and garden of residential gardens. What is walum min Allah akbar, and the pleasure from Allah which is the greatest and the highest, which is most important. Zalika huwa al-fawzul azim, and this is actually the greatest triumph and success. Here comes to an end the discourse which was revealed before the commencement of the journey to Tabuk. And now from 73 till the end of this surah, these are the different ayat which were revealed during this journey or when the Prophet and the Muslims had come back from Tabuk to Medina. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Azim wa nafani wa iyaakum bil ayati wa zikr al-hakim.
Allahu Akbar,
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us. or call our toll-free number, 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together, we can make a difference.